Robert.
Hey, what's going on, Constance Carter?
Oh, not a damn thing. It's what's today? Tuesday? It's Tuesday night, and
Tuesday all day long.
yeah, I'm super excited to have you as part of the staple of what we're doing over here on the show tonight. So I just want to make sure that I introduce Robert to the Fly Nubian Kings and Queens out there. Robert joined us last week when we talked about, what did we talk about last week, Rob?
I love that. What's your love language?
What's your love language? And we had so much fun. We had so much fun, you guys, and we decided to just kind of do this every week, talk about Black love and relationship goals. And so my boy Rob has decided to join the conversation every week with us, right?
Right up.
Yeah. So we actually have a panel of people because we want to talk to you today about toxic relationships and when to get out. But before we get into our conversation, Robert, before we get into the conversation, I want to tell them that we want them to come and join us every night. I want them to see you. I want them to get to know your light-skinned, green-eyed self and come and join us every night. So what they need to do is they need to go to Fly Nubian Queen on YouTube and please subscribe because we want you to get alerts when we come live to you every night, 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern. And then we want you to go over to Facebook and also make sure that you're following Fly Nubian Queen. Follow I Am Constance, or excuse me, follow Nobody Works Harder Than Constance Carter. Follow Rob. Rob, what's your handle?
I'm so busy looking at the feed at the bottom. I am Robert Antoinette on all social media platforms.
I am Robert Antoinette. I am, and I'm on I Am Constance Carter. So make sure you go over to Instagram right now and follow us on Instagram because we got a lot of great content. One of the things that we also do that I think is really cool, Rob, is we interview celebrities every Friday, right? On Conversation Starters Live. Are you there? Are you with me?
Yeah, I'm kind of I'm not used to like you're running the show, like you driving, right? So I'm just kind of like the co-pilot,
So
Brad Shaggy.
the funny thing is, Rob is used to driving. And on Conversation Starters Live, he's doing all the talking, and I'm just kind of like, yeah. So we actually host a show called Conversation Starters Live every Friday where we're interviewing all kinds of celebrities. Who are we interviewing?
Oh man, the selection and the lineup is great. Everybody from Generation Z, Josh X, old soul like Gerald Albright, Stedman Graham, Pastor Jamal Bryant. We've had Najee on. We've
Usher's
had
baby mama. We talked to Usher's baby mama. We talked to Lisa Nichols.
Chrisette Michelle. So
Warren G. G from Long Beach. So we do that all the time, every Friday. So you guys just make sure
Wait. You cannot forget your man, Damian Hall from Guy.
Yeah, that interview was definitely very, very interesting. So if you're interested in seeing any of our past interviews, go over to conversationstarters.live. And we've had some, that was a pretty controversial interview. It actually kind of went viral a little bit. But we ain't gonna talk about that right now, right, Rob? Because I actually got in trouble.
Absolutely right. So real quick, man, shout out to everybody. We thank you right now because you can be anywhere else in the world, but you are here with us. So do us a favor. Make sure you drop your name, drop what city you're from. Let us know that you're a part of this amazing conversation that we are about to have. Sisters, I know y'all always show up on Fly Nubian Queen, but I'm calling all the brothers. Yes, I'm calling all the brothers, Constance, to be a part of this conversation because I feel like if it's just me, myself, and I might not do well because the queens always win. So, brothers, make sure you jump on, comment in the feed, and let us know where you're watching from.
Yeah. So where are you watching from? Last night we had people coming tuning in from Africa. We have folks in Europe, Great Britain. We have people from Texas. So where you at? Where you at, Kings and Queens? Where you hailing from? Are you hailing from the East Coast, the West Coast? Is it time to go to bed where you are? Is it early morning where you at? We have people that are watching from all over the world. Rotasha says she's from Alabama. Where you from, Soup Bone? Candace says she's from Houston. Come on, H-Town.
What's going on, Sharon?
A
DC.
couple of them in DC. What? Okay. That's where your boy's from. Yes. Frank Marshall is from ATL. We got people from all over the globe that are actually watching right now. So we want to make sure that we acknowledge you, and we want to make sure that you're tuning in every day. to hear all of this great conversation. See, one of the things that's really important to both Rob and myself is that we talk about things that are uplifting. It's not just about generational wealth. Wealth is through a lot of different mediums. Wealth is financial, it's mental, it's spiritual, it's relational, it's all of those different things that we just want to kind of capture and tell you, you know, some of the things that we've been through, some of the things we haven't been through, but we know that other people have, and we want to show you how to get out so that you can live your best life. That's all this conversation is about. So it's actually a dialogue and not a monologue. We want you to join in. We want to talk to you about your specific situation. And so right now we're going to have a few people that we have that are going to talk about their individual situations around being in toxic relationships. You know, some of it has been mental. Some of it has been physical. Some of it has been financial. But we want to speak to all of those different things. So let's talk about it. Let's bring them in.
Man, while we're bringing them in, I want to shout out Lexi in the Colorado Springs, and Just Trice in Columbia, South Carolina, and Camille Tony Johnson from Iowa.
Okay, that's what's up. They are coming
from all over. I love it.
They are all over. Yvonne from Mississippi, Ingrid from Atlanta, Jennifer. Come on. Okay, so let's introduce everybody. Everybody, introduce yourselves.
I'm Marquita.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Kat.
All right.
Hey, I'm Jaron.
Okay. So all of these individuals here have been in a toxic relationship. And a toxic relationship is defined by so many things, but we wanted to make sure that we had the brothers represented on here, because a lot of times, you know, sisters will say that they've been in toxic relationships, but we don't really hear from the male point of view. So I want to start off with Jaron. Jaron, what type of toxic relationship have you been in?
I think that the one I had that was really significant was when I first got married before. Of course, I remarried again. So I married someone with seeing their representative first. And so after the representative left, I got to know who they really were. And come to find out, and I've learned over the years that they don't talk about toxic, abusive, verbal, physical relationship from a male point of view. It's almost a stigma of you don't cry, men don't cry, anything. So I learned early on that the person I married was extremely verbally abusive. And then when it got to a worse space, she became physically abusive when that didn't work. So being with someone who you're married to, who you love, and is basically not agreeing with you because the economy got bad, or you're, you know, something's going wrong and she punches you when you're try to communicate, it becomes really detrimental. But at the same time, you have no one to talk to, because who do you talk to about this stuff?
Who does a man talk to about a toxic, abusive relationship?
Well, Colin says, you know, I think so, Garen said, go ahead, Garen, go ahead.
No,
what I was going to say, Garen, just to be your amen on the line, it's tough when men are going through toxic relationships, because we tend to internalize a lot of things that are happening. And some things you can't, you know, share with your boys, because, you know, they're going to clown you or they're going to make it worse than what it is. And then the one thing that I will say about it, Garen, is that that representative that we meet in the beginning tends to be somebody else in the relationship. And the women and the men can say to both the same thing. But here's one thing that you said that resonated with me. Sometimes, sisters, sometimes y'all don't fight fair. Like, we might say something like, you ugly. But y'all will say something like, well, your mama didn't really want you. She wanted to have an abortion. And, you know, y'all just cut so deep. And that's something.
So
very interesting, because I've learned that I had friends that I had, like, certain people I would talk to, but they didn't know what to say. And at the time I was going to church, I actually had to talk to my pastor about it. And he didn't have kind of know what to say. He was kind of saying, you know, love her through it, all that stuff. So here I am trying to be the ideal good person, Christian, and all that stuff. But I love some. It's hard to love someone when they're hitting you, or they're saying you're nothing and, you know, all that stuff. Or their love was based on how much money you're bringing in. So It was an interesting dynamic. So I didn't have that problem where I had no one to talk to in terms of, like, but it just they didn't know what to say when I went to them. And you would think if you go to a pastor, oh, he'd be someone to talk to. That wouldn't happen. So being young and going through the situation almost by yourself was really a challenging time at that particular point in time.
I can imagine that, because that's, you know, a lot of men have to suffer in silence when you're talking about abusive relationships and toxic relationships. So I could imagine that it had to be pretty lonely. Like, you don't have anybody to talk to. And so what do you do as a man? Just like somebody said, it's like they're saying that you're not manly. They're saying that you're, you know, you're a wimp. They're saying that, you know, you a crybaby because you got this woman that you don't, that you obviously you're stronger than. You could probably lay her out, lay hands on her if you wanted to. But being the man that you are, you don't want to. And then you're just kind of like alone and you have nobody to talk to. The thing about us as women is that when we go through it, a lot of us have been through the same things. And it's something that we can kind of share together and help each other through. But I feel kind of bad that, you know, I wonder if there's like any like group support groups that deal with that for men.
Oh, well, I tell you what,
at the time, I never saw that. So.
Garen, take your problems to the barbershop. Everything you need about life, love, and relationships, you can get the right answer at the barbershop. And if nothing else, they'll give you courage.
The barbershop.
Yeah, they'll give you courage to say the things that you've been wanting to say. Because, you know, depending on who your pastor is, you know, I heard you say that you were married. I believe that, well, let me just say this for the benefit of everybody on the stage. When I get married, it's going to be until death do us part. When she say I'm leaving, I'm packing my bags. And where are we going? We ain't knowing this thing for one time, right? But those vows are really, really serious. When you say until death do us part, like, you know, like the gospel of Andre 3000, forever, ever, forever, ever, forever, ever. That's a long time. So you need to make sure on the front end that this person is the person you want to be with. And I'm sure there's some level of assessment that you need to do. Like, the ladies have a list, Garrett. I mean, I believe the brothers, we need to do the same thing. To check off all those items to make sure that if this happens, you know, here's our strategy to overcome and to get past this and to get past that. And the other thing is to just make the vow to, in the words of Kevin Hart, have your safe word, pineapples, so you can fight fair, because sometimes they can dig deep and like just question your manhood, start talking about your money, talk about your mama, talk about your job, your car you driving. And those things are like really, really outward manifestations of our manhood. And heaven forbid they talk about your work in the bedroom, like game over. Like, he's like, I got nothing.
Yeah, so, you know, the thing about it is a lot of people, and I think,
you know what?
No, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, there's a little delay. Oh, there's a little delay when you guys talk, so that's why it seems like I'm jumping. Interesting enough, I'm on my second marriage, and I've been married for over 14, 15 years now. The first time, I didn't have a list, and I kind of thought it more for a man's perspective. And my naivety in the whole situation was not seeing the red flags and thinking of her rules. But again, what do I know? I'm something in early 20s at the time, didn't know no better. And so this, by the time I got to the first one and got whole, they're not a list together. So I'm with you. And I saw that conversation before about the listing, and I thought it was imperative, because without a list, you know, and not knowing who you are to make the list, and you get in a whole lot more trouble and you repeat the same mistakes over and over again. So I didn't want to go through that same cycle, because I figured I'd be in jail. So I figured, you know myself, know a list.
Let me tell you something. I read a meme somewhere that said red flags be looking like Six Flags when you're feeling the mother. Let me say that one more time. Red flags be looking like Six Flags when you're feeling the mother. So a lot of times we see these red flags at some point during the courtship before we get married, but we are feeling that person so much we don't even know that these red flags are like ding, 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 ding. All these things are going off. And when you get married, sometimes you probably were married really young, because Garen and I went to elementary school together, junior high school together. So we're the same age. So you probably got married really young, and you didn't know what you were looking for in a relationship. So I could imagine that, you know, trying to have something and people sending their representatives, because I think that's going to be the recurring theme with everybody. But let me ask you, Marquita, like, for you, what did that toxic relationship look like?
Ooh, so me and my now ex-husband, we got together very young. So he was 16 and I was 17. And I think it, well, I honestly, it was the sex that linked us together for so long. Like, you know, honestly speaking, hands down, the sex was great. It was absolutely amazing. But being so young and not knowing myself and dealing with insecurities and low self-esteem, having sex that young, I didn't really understand soul ties and how deep that was. And we connected and we got used to each other. And it was almost like, well, the next step is to get married. Okay, now we're married. The next step after that is to have babies. Now we have babies. And that, and meanwhile, all this time, we're fighting, we're arguing, but the sex is good. But we're fighting and we're arguing, but the sex is good. It was, it got to a point where I commend him for doing what needed to be done a long time ago, because I couldn't do it because I was so deep in it. He finally called it quits. I mean, he knew it had to end. And, you know, 20 years, three kids later, it's like, okay, we can't keep doing this. And I was devastated when he left, because I was like, what you mean? I stuck by you. What you mean you leaving me now? But I do, you know, going through my growth journey right now and healing, I respect him for being the strong one to say, no, we can't do this anymore. And he walked away. But it was the intimacy that really kept us linked. And I really believe in soul ties. I believe wholeheartedly in soul ties. And for me, I've decided, you know, I cannot be intimate with someone in that way unless I'm really sure you are the one for me. Because I feel like that was a sentence, a 20-year sentence that me and him both, we had to endure just because we were young and dumb and, you know.
So, Constance, what I'm hearing is that Marquita was in good dick jail. 20 years
long. I don't want to say all that, bro. My reward.
It comes to a point, Constance, where you have to not say it's good dick, but it's great dick. Really? 20 years in. My lord. I apologize.
And the sentence was right. We grown. I gotta take my shoes off of this.
But he's a good guy, you know. My ex-husband, wow. He's a good man. But it was just, we were both just young, you know, we didn't know. And we just thought, okay, well, we've been together for so long. The next step, move in together. Okay, now let's get married. Okay, let's have kids. But we're still fighting and arguing, but we always came back together in the bedroom.
Was good dick of doing.
Somebody said good D will make you listen. No, you want that, I want that good.
I'm sorry.
So was there any infidelity on anybody's part?
Yeah, there was a lot of infidelity on his part. Oh. But you know, I think now looking back, because hindsight really is 2020. And I'm not making excuses for him, but I'm understanding he was with me since 16. And so I believe that he wanted to stay, but he also wanted to be single. You know, he never really got a chance to be a single man. And now here we are at 40, 41, and he's finally being able to be out and be single. So at 16, you know, having a girlfriend, having a fiance, having kids, and it's like he has one foot in the single life and one foot in marriage. And, you know, at the time, of course, I was pissed off because you're cheating on me. But like I said, hindsight is 2020. I kind of understand it. He was like, I love you, but I, and then he was in a fraternity too, you know, and the temptations that go on with that. So it was a lot of infidelity on his part.
Yeah. All right. So Kat, what about you?
Well, mine is fresh. So I'm learning. My journey has been, let's just say, I'm healing, but I'm enjoying the healing process of the journey. Because I know I kind of am figuring out and piecing together my issue and what I'm looking for. I never knew my father growing up. I met him when I was 18.
Wow.
So it was a lot of different hurts, like thinking your stepfather is your father, but finding out one day by family members, that's not your dad. And then, you know, learning later on, oh, here's your dad, you know? So I think as a young woman, I always yearn for approval from a man. So I was impressionable as a young woman. So of course, if a man, knowing what I know now, if a man see that, they can take advantage of that because you can be molded into what they want. But when you're young and you don't know yourself and you're trying to discover yourself, why, while growing up still, trying to be a mom, trying to be a wife, trying to be all these hats, you know, you fail.
How old were you when you got married?
I was 23, 24.
And how old are you now? I mean, I don't want to say that, but how long were you married?
I was married for over 20 years.
Wow. And so you're divorced now. So what kind of things happened in your toxic marriage?
Now that I'm learning, everything, abuse,
physical,
emotional. I think it's not, nobody should be physically abused, but I'd rather have took the physical abuse because the mental stuff messes with you more, especially when you have a strong mind. You know where you want to go, you know where, what you want to do in life, but it doesn't fit someone else's agenda that you're trying to constantly please.
So how were you finally able to get out?
When I started questioning my existence.
Ooh, what was
that's
that?
When I walked.
What was that like? What do you mean?
When I didn't no longer want to be here, that's when I walked.
Mm. How many people come?
I just want to say to you, Kat, that you know I applaud anybody that is on the other side of their toxic situation. I mean, I look at you on the screen, and I can just exalt you and lift you right now and tell you that you're so beautiful. You are a queen and you deserve absolute excellence.
Yeah.
And if you're not finding it in your mate, you know, there's certainly different things that you can do, affirmation, spirituality, whatever it is where you find your zen and your peaceful place. But let me just speak truth to you right now that you are brilliantly and wonderfully and fearfully made, right? You are beautifully flawed. You are allowed to be flawed and beautiful at the same time. You are allowed to be a little bit crazy and still hold it down. You are allowed to be everything that a woman is. And I get so angry sometimes when women, you guys don't see the beauty in the mirror that we see. Like if you actually saw, like you really took a look at that beautiful image that's staring right back at you, you would never allow yourself to go through some of the mental anguish that you go through. Obviously, it's easy for me to say on the outside looking in, but I just want to confirm for you that if nobody's ever told you, you are beautiful, you are deserving of the best, and I just see nothing but greatness happen for you on the other side. I just recognize you have removed that toxic situation from your life.
Thank you.
Do you think the sex that kept you, what do you think that kept you in the relationship so long?
Not wanting to fail.
Not wanting to fail in your marriage?
Because I watched my mom in her marriages fail.
Mm.
I watched other women before me fail. I thought I could change. I could make it. I could break that cycle of failing. So I stayed. And of course, like, you know, you hear these stories like, you know, I even done it myself. I wouldn't stay in that. Let me tell you, you don't know what you will stay in.
Right.
You've been in it.
Right.
And so for people to judge others that are in toxic relationships, you don't know the story that led up to that relationship. You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of, I'm just so grateful of this journey, because unknowingly, through healing myself, I'm helping others. Like, also, and once I realized that, it's like, okay, I'm not alone.
Yeah.
I got this.
So how did, I know you said that once you question your existence was when you decided to leave, but how did you get the strength? Because it's one thing to say, okay, I deserve more, but how did you get the strength to actually walk away from that toxic? And that's a toxic relationship. That's a question for all of you, because I think people are dealing with that right now, is they're in this relationship, but they don't have the courage or the strength or the wherewithal to get out of it. What did you do?
I quit feeling sorry for myself. I quit painting over a canopy that have already been laid out. I had to stop. I had to quit. I had to quit making excuses for things I didn't have control over. You know, I had to quit or get tired of trying so hard to make something work, you know, or trying to put this shoe on that was so tight. It hurts. My feet are bleeding, but I'm still wearing this shoe. Why? I don't know.
Were you afraid of being alone? It was everything.
It was a financially insecurity. Like, who's going to protect me?
Yeah.
I don't know how to do certain things. Yeah. You know. It was a bunch of fears on top of things that had already been instilled in me that weren't my fears that I'm learning now, that kept me there, that kept me paralyzed. Like, I'm learning so much. It's just too much to like try to explain because this journey is so personal. I never would be where I'm at right now. When you asked me, you know, to be on this, the old cat would have said, absolutely not. Because the embarrassment. But this is my healing right here. This is part of my journey.
Yeah, Kat, one thing I'll comment on, and I've talked to so many people about this, Constance, you and I have talked about this. You know, the one thing that keeps people together are outside opinions. You know, if you've ever been on a double date and then one person out of the other couple, they break up or they separate, or one person cheats on the other, it's kind of hard to kind of broach, you know, what do you do? And we get caught up in what other people are thinking. But let me tell you right here, right now, you only get one chance to live this life.
Amen.
You only get one.
Yep.
So when you feel yourself approaching, you know, something that doesn't feel right for you and you can't make it right, the last thing I want you to do is think about what somebody else is saying, because P.S. for everybody listening in the back, they got bigger problems than the ones that you got. So don't worry about what they're going to think and what they're going to say, because, you know, you have to live your life for you. I understand kids. I understand protection. I understand the financial aspect. But I would not base my final decision on what other people think.
That's kind of hard, though, because, you know, sometimes you'll have family that's like, you know, putting that pressure on you and saying, girl, you know, you got kids.
Why
leave? Or you got, you know, you have the appearances. Well, you know, everybody thinks on the outside we're a perfect family. So I don't want nobody to know that we're not what they thought we were.
Yeah.
And those things like kind of keep you bound to situations that you don't want to be bound to.
Right.
That they make you stay a lot longer. And so then having the courage to just say, you know what, F what everybody thinks, I'm free.
Yeah.
I bet you have so much peace now.
Oh my God, Constance, you don't even know. Like, when I walked, it was like, wow, why didn't I do this before? Like, That was easy. It was easy. When I was ready, it was easy. It was hard when I wasn't ready. But I was ready. You know, I didn't care about the who's going to protect me. Because I remember I come from a Christian family. God protects me.
Oh, yes.
You know, yes. Like things that were fed into me that I forgot about started coming back to me. So
here's a question, Kat, and I like to ask everybody in the room, Constance, Mark, Marquita, and Garen. Let's say you identified an abusive relationship in your circle of influence, some of your good girlfriends or some of your homeboys, right? You notice that there is some abuse. You see the black eye, you see the busted lip, you see the marks and the band-aids. How do you, from the outside looking in, address that? Or do you say nothing? How do you address an abusive relationship? In this day and era, here in 2021, here in 2020, how would you address that? Or what advice would you give to our audience who's listening? Because there's somebody out there who knows about an abusive situation happening right now. And this is such an urgent matter that we deal with from our parents and our foreparents before them up till now.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody screaming out, but there's so many silent sufferers out there. And I like to speak to them if it's your opinion or facts or best practices. And I like for the room to kind of answer that.
Well, I'll go ahead and say this real quick. I know I would say something to my friend because nobody quickly, you can look it up. I'm from Buffalo, New York. My cousin was murdered because she kept her mouth shut.
Wow.
She didn't speak to nobody. So when she's gone, we're all surprised. Mm-hmm. The worst murder in Buffalo ever. That stuck with me. My first cousin, gone. Mm. I don't want to be that woman. Or I don't want to be that woman on the other side that snapped. You know what I'm saying? That just ends it all. Because it's emotional. When you've put in so much with a person and people like, oh, you could, you know, walk or whatever. You know, when your heart is set and your love is so strong for someone, you don't know what that person's going to do. So if you see that loved one with a black eye, or you know there's abuse, intervene. Don't just say it's not my problem. Turn your head or, you know, think it's normal. It's not. Say something. You may be that lifeline they needed.
Mm-hmm. Mm. One of the things somebody said in the comments, though, was that when you do, they'll lash out at you. They get mad at you. And I've had friends with abusive relationships, and they would say, you know, before I was with this man, I would be like, that's stupid. Just like you said, Kat, that's stupid. I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't put up with that. But when you're in it,
it's a whole different ball.
It's different. Because when you're abused like that, especially mental, you're protecting everybody. I don't know about abused men, but as a woman, you're protecting your children. You're protecting your abuser. You're protecting everybody but yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'd never suffered with physical abuse. But I think for me, if I'm honest, I don't know what I would say. Just because, like Constance, whoever said this, you know, you run the risk of that person lashing out on you. And then what do you do when you're trying to come from a good place? I think most people maybe just want to know that they have someone. When you're ready to talk to me, I'm here. Mm-hmm. And I think you have to let that person come to you and pray that they come to you in time. But let that person come to you when they're ready. But I, you know, for me, if I'm honest, I don't know what I would do. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I think
what about you, Jerry?
With me, because In my situation, I realized because I loved her, I kept staying and staying and staying and making it work. We had a kid involved. And it got to the point where after like breakups and she taking me back and she begging me to come back, I realized the one thing that really broke free for me was
I said, loving you is killing me. And so thinking that going forward, and what was I willing to do to break away? And because of our situation, we lived where she worked. So my mindset was I was willing to be homeless to get away from you.
Woo.
So I was willing to live in a car because we broke up around the recession time, where there were, you know, recession 2001, 2002. And so everything dropped down money. I was like, I was willing to be homeless to get. So I just opposed that to when I see that happening in the future, I always come from a perspective was if I can do it, you can do it. And if you're willing to break out of that fear, what will happen if I leave? What will happen there? And once you step into that, you realize it's not as bad as you thought it was. It's just that fear that holds you into that situation. Then you're allowed to be able to talk to someone effectively, because the first thing most people say is you don't understand. You don't understand what I'm going through. You don't understand. I love them. And I can sit there and say, yeah, I do understand, because I was where you were, you know, from a woman, not so much from a woman's perspective, but a woman's perspective, but also a man's. I was there where you were. And so what do you want to do for your peace of mind and your happiness? And then I've learned that some people don't want to get out. So you can't talk to someone that don't want to get out. So you almost have to throw nuggets here and there. You know, you can't just sit down for 1 hour and they say, yeah, you're right, I'm going to get out. You have to stay with them and be constant and throw nuggets and say, I'm here for you. And just be a shoulder to cry on until they get the strength. Because sometimes they need that help to be able to come out and say, I need help, but I don't know how. And so I've always made myself available to be able for those people that need that help. And I've dealt with them going forward, men in bad relationships, women in bad relationships. And I always say the same thing. I was there. I understand. You know, I'm here for you. It's not about giving you a great scripture. It's not about giving you a message. Sometimes it's sitting there with you and crying with you. Yeah. Because I can relate where you are. But at the same time, I came out the other side. And I'm okay. And I got healthy and I got remarried and I'm in a happy marriage and my marriage is going good. So I'm not so special where you can't do it too. You know, I'm not better than you. But I always keep that. I'm always being available and make sure when they're ready to hear what you have to say to go forward.
Listen, you know, it's real when they say, when a brother says, I am willing to be homeless.
Right. Right.
I am willing to be homeless. Yes, I need to get out.
Oh.
Yeah.
I stayed in my car.
You know, I commend Kat because I'm on the same journey of healing and growth and learning. So like I said, my ex and I, we were together very young. So in this season of my life, I'm finally getting to learn who Marquita is. And I think we often underestimate the power of healing, because I know as soon as I broke away from my ex, I was ready to jump into something else because I did not want to be alone. I needed a warm body next to me. And it just didn't, I was so broken. I was so hurt. And my emotional intelligence was just non-existent. That me trying to get into a relationship with somebody else, it was just a wreck. And finally, I was like, Lord, okay, what? What do you need me to do? I literally just broke down and was like, Lord, what do I need to do? And he said, you need to heal.
Yeah. You're
not ready for anything. You need to allow me to heal you. And it does get lonely, you know, being alone, but I would never want to be in another toxic relationship.
Neither. I'd rather be alone.
That was a 20-year lesson. I don't need a repeat. I don't need to go back to school. I've learned my lesson. Let me heal and now figure out who is Marquita? What do you want? What are you looking for? And the person that you want, are you that same person for him? And I'm like, I want a good man. Okay, well, honey, you need to be a good woman. Well, what does that look like?
Right.
Okay, I need to figure out what that looks like because I really don't know.
So, yeah. So let me take a minute. really quick, Rob, let me just take a minute to let everybody know this is such an important conversation. We want to make sure that you're sharing this with everybody because there's some people who are suffering in silence. They don't know how to get out. So it's important that you share this information out because some people just, you know, there's a word, there are words that have been spoken today that could be transformational for people's lives. So make sure you're not only hitting the thumbs up button, but you're sharing this. So if you're on YouTube, go ahead and hit the thumbs up. Make sure you grab the link and you send it out to all your good girlfriends and your boyfriends and everybody that you know. If you are on Facebook, make sure you are sharing this information because it's something that could actually save someone's life.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I appreciate the transparency that Kat and Marquita and Garen that you're sharing because these are real situations that we're all going through, right? And I know for me, I've never been married for the reason, those reasons that you guys talk about. You know, I didn't think I was mature enough to handle being in a relationship, you know, as a committed husband and wife. For me, I know that a lot of the jobs that I had, I was in the public eye a lot. So I didn't want infidelity to be an issue. I didn't want a lot of maturity issues where, you know, sharing your space. I didn't want to have to do that because I'm an only child, right? Constance and I, that she teases me about that all the time. I'm mature now, but back then I don't think that I would have handled it. So what advice would you give to your kids about relationships? Because the Generation Z, they got access to so much information. Whatever they don't know, they don't ask mom and daddy no more. They just Google it. But there's some things that Google can't tell you about. There are some headaches that Google can't help you to avoid. So in terms of sound advice, especially when choosing a mate on the other side, on the side of healing, after going through the good dick club, after having, you know, a toxic situation, you know, just turn you to another situation. What kind of advice would you guys give to your son or your daughter on the day before their wedding? What kind of advice would you give to your son or your daughter? Tips, tricks, tools to have success in this marriage?
Well, I wouldn't even wait till the day of my wedding, the wedding. I had an 18 and 19 year old, so I would talk to them in the very beginning, especially when they started bringing someone home, and I would be their counselor per se, an advocate. And, you know, kids don't always know, they want to do what they want to do. So I would rather be able to say, I told you so, then I'm sorry for not telling you anything, you know? And I joke with my son a lot because he'll do stuff and, you know, I'll say, go ahead and say it. And I want him here to say, Dad, you're right. And it's a joke we do because I'm, you know, I'm like, go ahead and do it. But Dad, you're gonna come back and say, Dad, you're right. And I do it with my daughter as well in a different way. But I always wanted to let them know that I've been there where you've been before. So there's nothing that you haven't done that you're gonna do that I haven't done or don't know someone who did.
Yeah.
And so, I try to give them that advice and I'm gonna let them do what they wanna do in the fall, but at least they can sit there and say, okay, Dad, after the first time they can sit there and say, okay, Dad told me this, so they know what to look for, so they know it. And then they kind of builds the trust and the confidence in saying, hey, Dad's gonna give me advice on this and he knows what he's talking about. And same with, you know, my wife doing the same thing. So I always try to start early and not get to, like you said, before they say I do, just be like, yeah, he's not right for you because this is what I see in him and this is what he's gonna be doing. And be careful for these signs and watch out for this and watch out for that. If you do that in the beginning, then they could get privy to the signs and see the flags and not jump over them like I did and stop and be like, all right, I'm out. You know,
celebrating the flags.
Yeah, you know.
Well, with my daughters, the most sound advice that I've given my daughters, and they're teenagers now, and I'm going to try to keep this PG, but I've told them, ain't no boy right now looking to be your knight shining armor. These young men have testosterone that's pumping through their veins. And they looking to stick that somewhere. So, and it's not that they, I never want to make men or young men be a villain, but it's just the nature of the beast. Right now, they're not looking to make you their wife. They're not looking to make you their long-term girlfriend. So you giving your body to them is not going to make him stay with you. He's not looking to be your husband. He don't know what a husband is. He just knows he got this testosterone jumping and the pumping, and he needs to release it. And if he does not have the mature men in his life to guide him and teach him, he's going to sow his oats, and you don't want to be one of the ones he sows his oats on, because then he's not staying. He's going to move on to the next one. So, I mean, I have real conversations with my daughters. I don't sugarcoat nothing. We use words. I use the language that they use. I come to them the same way that y'all talk to y'all girls. You're going to talk to mom the same way, because I want you to get this information from me and not from the internet and not from your girlfriend who think they know and she don't know. So, like I said, my sound advice to my daughters is don't look for no boy to be your knight in shining armor. That's not what they're trying to do right now.
Okay. Hard. Oh, go ahead.
Well, my boys are grown. My oldest is 28 and my baby boy is what, 22? And I always tell them now, you know, love yourself first before you go trying to look on somebody else.
Yeah.
Because if you don't love yourself first, how are you going to have patience? How are you going to be a leader? How are you going to lead your family if you can't be patient with your wife? Or, you know, vice versa. Yeah. You know, if you're not uplifting and growing together, my motto is I don't need to be with you.
Amen.
My daughter's 21, and I always tell her, you know, she's just got her first boyfriend like 3 or 4 months ago, her first official boyfriend. And so, you know, I've been telling her since she was like 16, like, wait until you 30, travel, do some things. Oh yeah, mom, I'm gonna do that. But now that she got a boyfriend, it's a whole different ball game, you know. So I just pray that the things that you instill into them, because they, you really don't know yourself. You know, and I think a lot of when we talk about the toxic relationships, I think the common denominator with the three is you got married so young without knowing who you are first. So somebody said, know thyself first. So Rob, you really know yourself, right? You have been in the oven. You are overly baked. You are ready.
No, I'm in a crock pot, Constance. I'm slow. It's marinating.
That's right. But for most people who have discovered that they're in the toxic relationships, they had gotten into them so young before they knew who they were. And then you stayed so long because you still don't know who you are. Yeah. And then as you start to know who you are, know what you want, know what you like, then you're looking, you're like,
Right. And I did not know how to be a wife.
Yeah.
There are, you know, a wife is not just looking good and having sex all the time and cooking and cleaning. There's more to being a wife. And one of the things that I am learning is I did not respect my husband.
Wow.
I just didn't respect him. Yeah. And he did not love me. And so we were caught in this cycle, because how can you love someone that you don't respect? And how can you respect someone that you don't love? And there was just this toxic cycle that we were going through, because there was no love there. He didn't know how to love a wife. He didn't know what it meant to love a wife. And I didn't know what it meant to love a husband. And I think on my journey now, you know, I pray, you know, I want to get married again someday. But, you know,
Really, Marquita, do you want to do that again?
I do want to do it again. I do want to do it again, because my marriage did not leave such a bad taste in my mouth, because I'm understanding what the issue was. We were just young and didn't know. We got used to each other. And now that I'm understanding myself and I'm understanding what it means to love thyself first, know thyself first. Okay. And then once you do that, then you can move on. And this is how you love someone else. I'm learning. I'm not, you know, I'm not in the crock pot. I was just out. So now I'm in it and I'm taking it slow and I'm understanding and I'm getting that education and that knowledge. And I grew up in the streets, so I didn't have a mom to teach me how to be a woman. I didn't have a dad to tell me about men. Everything that I've learned in the streets. Wow. So now being older and a little bit more wiser, I'm like, oh, I wasn't supposed to do that.
Yeah.
I went, oh, that's what that means. It's a lot of aha moments happening in my life now.
I can respect that though, because it's not, you didn't just blame him for the toxicity. You also took accountability for yourself. So I can definitely appreciate and respect that. How long, so are you currently divorced, and are your divorces final, Kat and Marquita?
Not yet. It'll be divorced soon. And it's hard, you know, I'm not going to say that this process is easy, and it's hard for both of us. I went through the bitter phase, so I don't want people to think that there is not that phase where you are angry and you're going through that, because it's like a death. So you're going through the, what is it, the
phase, mourning.
Grief, the mourning. And so you're angry, you're depressed, you're bargaining, you're all these things, and I finally come to acceptance and forgiveness. Mm. Oh my goodness, forgiveness.
Mm.
That, for me, I did not know how huge that was to forgive him, because just like, you know, just like me, he didn't know. He didn't know, and I didn't know. Mm. And we're in a much, much better place. And we can co-parent effectively. And, you know, it hurts, but we were just not yoked for one another. We just weren't yoked. So
I think with me, like when you're saying stuff, I think the one thing no one taught me was how to deal with the divorce, the feeling of death and going through it.
Mm-hmm.
Understanding that toxic relationship means you're toxic. And you have to detox.
Yes.
And all these things no one told me. And like a dummy, I jumped in a bed with someone else and started dating other people while I was still trying to detox and figure things out. And I learned that when I started, if I wasn't careful, I would have got with someone in my toxicity and been almost in a, not in a bad situation, but have been with someone I was like, I got with you for a moment.
Yeah.
And I remember I was dating someone, and like the better I got, the more I kept thinking, why am I with you?
Yeah.
And then I realized I was with her because I was just wanted someone to hold or hug or hang out with and all that stuff. Yeah. And so I had to spend time by myself. And a lot of people don't think about the detoxicity of the situation, how long it'll take you to detox all this stuff and then relearn new ways, behaviors, how to be a husband, how to be a man, how to look for a wife. The Bible says a man who finds a wife finds a good thing. So what are the signs do I look for in a wife? That means I got to understand what a wife does. I got to understand what the head household is, what the head is. All the stuff no one taught me, so I'm figuring out on my own. You know, and my friends weren't in great situations either, so it wasn't like I could lean to them. So right. Just a time of studying, recognizing, self-analyzing, realizing who you are in God, who God called you to be, you know, what fits with you, who you, how does it work out? So all those things were discovering aspects, and so it wasn't like, like with you, you're saying how like some people like to be single. I knew I wanted to be married.
Mm.
So I also knew that because I wanted to be married, I didn't want to go in it and have the same results as I did last time.
Yeah.
And I'm into the death doers part. And that's one of the reasons that kept me in it, because in my mind, I'm like, death doers part. I gotta do this thing. So sometimes we miss that detox period, and we miss the who are we after we detox, and you know, who are we called to be? You know, I could be an entrepreneur, didn't even know it, because I'm just stuck in this whole crazy stuff, you know. All those things we missed out on. So a lot of times people think that, you know, I'm old in with new, and it's a simple, like, turn the page and you're good. But that's not the case. You need time to discover who you are, time to learn new things and get into the word or get into self-help courses or get into whatever you believe in to help. Because, you know, I don't pertain to everybody believes what I believe. So moving from there.
Can I say something real quick? Because I saw a comment come across the board and it said, I'm not divorced yet, and I'm ready to get married again. I just want to address that. Just because I'm not divorced yet doesn't mean I'm going to go get married tomorrow. because there is still some healing and some learning of myself that I have to do. But I don't feel, and this is my personal belief, that just because your marriage failed, that means marriage is a failure.
Right.
I don't believe marriage is a failure.
I got nobody lined up. She got nobody lined up.
That marriage just did not work out. And there were lessons that I learned from that marriage. But like I said, I'm not about to get married tomorrow. No. But whenever God decides, okay, now you're ready, and he sends that man to me, then that's when I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
I think marriage is beautiful.
Yeah. It is.
So that was a question that I was going to ask. Like, in terms of married or being single, it seems that in spite of the lessons, the hard knock lessons that you learn in your relationships, are you still willing to give love a try? More importantly, you're willing to try the matrimony thing once again?
Oh yes, love is God.
Yeah,
you know, love is beautiful.
Yeah,
but again, you have to know yourself.
Yeah,
you know, and I think with removing intimacy. And again, I speak for me. I'm able to see the red flags. You know, I'm able to discern a little bit better because I'm not jumping into bed with somebody else. And I think when we do that, we turn off that sixth sense per se, and we ignore those signs. And I believe, you know, in the word, it's, you know, to not be out here, you know, having sex.
Let's talk about that really quick.
And it's not to condemn anybody, but I think it really blocks that sense. It really blocks you from being able to see those red flags that end up looking like six flags because you so in love, and you in love with the D, and you not love with him or with her. So, you know, to me, love is beautiful, but I think somebody had wrote that there is levels to it.
So next time you are you staying celibate until you get married?
Yes, child. Yes. It's hard now. It's hard because there's some fine brothers out here. But I'm not willing to pay the price. That's what it is. There's a high price tag for me to put myself out there. And I don't want to pay that price. I'm not willing to pay that price.
What about you, Kat? Are you waiting? You get remarried before you?
I'm just going to go sit over here and keep learning these lessons and fixing me, because I know I'm not ready. I ain't even gonna sit up here and try to entertain that thought, because it's too fresh. I don't know. You know, I didn't know what I was doing for 17, 20 years. You know, I sure in the heck don't know what I'm doing today. So I'm just gonna sit over here and go on and wait on Jesus.
Amen. I believe the one that God sends me, he understands. You don't understand that you're not the one for me.
You don't believe in test driving?
Test driving?
Maybe test driving after you've gotten to know him.
My girlfriends have told me, like, you don't even want to test drive?
Just listen. Test driving is scary when you don't know how to drive, okay? I'm just going to go on and say that. Because I did, you know. I secretly listened to some of my friends, girl, just, you know, learn and love yourself. And the type of person I am, I'm like, I'm learning, I'm loving, but I'm gonna go on and just date and start real quick. And then, you know, and then I was like, oh, I don't know what the hell we're doing. It's some real nuts out here. I was married to one, but damn, you're like, man, that's like not too bad. Like, real scary.
Yeah.
My grandfather used to tell me, when I was a little girl, he gone now. But he used to tell me, watch what you bait your hook with. You might throw your line in that pond and pull out a boot. Mm-hmm. And when I was a young one, I'm like, what is he talking about? Like, watch what I bait my hook with in the boot. You know, I didn't get it. I get it I get it now.
I did have an instance right after I got out in the bed with somebody. It was a disaster. It was an absolute disaster. And I was like, okay, Lord, this ain't for me. Like, this is just, because I was so emotionally broken, I probably scared the crap out of this man. He was probably like, what in the world? Because I was so needy and, you know, calling and, you know, I want to see you and crying and I'm your wife. And I'm lady, no. Yeah, it was bad. It was really bad. So after that experience, I was like, yeah, I'm going to just keep Kitty to myself.
Marquis, you had the man over there like,
yeah. You know what? There's too many things I can focus my attention on. You know, I can get a puppy, a goldfish, you know.
It was just really, really bad for me.
You know, a lot of times people, and we're going to wrap this up shortly, but a lot of times people, because our mamas and our grandmamas, and, you know, they stayed in these marriages for 50 years, in these toxic marriages for 50 years, you know, and then they teach us to do the same. And, you know, we're listening to the Bible that says, you know, don't, unless there's an issue of adultery, like you cannot have that marriage. You know, what do you do? Because that's the culture, you know, if you're a Christian, if you're a believer, that's what we are taught. So, you know, justifying, even if it is a toxic marriage, you go to your pastor a lot of times, they'll tell you, you know, pray through it.
Cause, you know what I learned is that we often two times depend on the pastor to be God and don't read the Bible for ourselves. And oftentimes the pastor will give you a over surface level, and it's in the deepness of the word of getting to know God yourself is when those things you come revelatory. And you don't care if the pastor says certain things.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, if joy comes in the morning, that means you still have to go through hours of darkness.
Right.
Oh. And people don't see that. Yeah. You know, glory to glory means there's an in-between part where there's not a glory moment. You know, there's things that people don't understand if they just look the Bible, read one scripture and go away, compared to meditating the word, as David says, not day and night. And when you can do that, then you understand purpose. And when you understand purpose, certain things don't affect you. It won't become major in your life. So when you're talking about sex, if you're itching for sex so bad or to stay in the marriage, it short-term needs affect long-term goals.
Yeah.
You know, and if we want to get married again, but we're jumping in bed to satisfy a legitimate lead in an illegitimate place, then we're always going to fall short of what we want. And so if you're a Christian and you're saying, I believe in marriage, and you're not reading the Bible, then you're kind of like, you know, in the outer courts, hoping for a word from somebody on every Sunday morning, and compared to having a relationship and saying, what does it mean when you say this about marriage, Lord? What does it mean when I'm in a toxic relationship and I don't want to get out because I'm honoring the word?
That is a problem for a lot of people. Yeah. And that's the reason why they stay.
Yeah. And I've learned, because I kind of fell in that initially when I first got saved all those years ago, and they were just saying the catchphrases. And I'm like, wait a minute. After a while, I was like, if I'm depending on you, I might as well make you my God. I might as well call you and pray to you every night, you know. So what did God say about this? And as I started to look in it, I realized my purpose is in God, not in man, not in a woman. I mean, not mad, but not in a woman or going to a man to get advice from. My purpose is in God. God put it in me. And if he's the creator and he created me, then I should go to the creator to act about the creation that he created, which is me. So the more I do that, the more I understand who I'm called to be and who I'm called to strive to help people, or strive to help do this, or strive to do that. You know, what, like, constantly I look at you and you wrote books. You know, that's a growth part, because when you first started, you talked about being broke, and then you talked about going to real estate. Then after you got into real estate, you got into being a broker. And after you got a broker, you're like, hey, I want to do this. It's like elevations that didn't happen overnight.
Right.
But it was something that was in you that came out.
Right.
And how do we get that if we don't know who we are, or finding out who we called to be or what purpose is? And now you're about helping people. All that is a gradual stage that we miss out on if we're just going to, you know, get, we can find, you know, who's in our bed, we'll focus on that, because really our spouse should be the one that helps us get to the win. The husband's supposed to lead, the woman should be the helpmate or vice versa, you know, because not always about the man, and we go from there. But, you know, when we talk about biblical stuff, we just surface level a lot of things and we don't dive deeper into it. And what does it mean for us? And what does it mean as far as my purpose to what it is? And what my purpose is different from what your purpose is. So I can't look at your purpose and say, that should be me, and try to jump on the bad way, because it won't work.
Yeah. How many people in that are watching right now, how many of you are willing to abstain before marriage? What percentage do you think that is? Because I think we talked about that, Rob, on our last show, right? Talking about people abstaining, and you said it was like 2%.
I think the clarification of what I was saying is that there are so many visual triggers on TV, on internet. I mean, how many of us know that we can type in a few four-letter words and you'll have a whole catalog of visual attractions that will put you in places that you probably wouldn't be in if you weren't exposed to that kind of thing. So I think the larger point that I was trying to make, that although we may be striving for abstinence and we know what the right thing is to do, but you know, time, space, and opportunity, you know, it wears on you. And once you have that mental picture, it's hard to get rid of it. I'll tell you this. I remember I'm old school, where I remember when Nightmare on Elm Street came out, and it wasn't the movie itself. It was the image that it put in my head that made me not want to sleep with the lights off. You know, I hadn't had one light on or the TV on. It's the mental image that's portrayed in our head. And because most of us consume so much trash and reality TV and you know, the internet, I think the point I was trying to make is that it's difficult. So Marquita is part of the 2% where she can walk past, you know, Idris Elba and walk past, you know, some of the fine brothers out there in film today, the more chestnuts of the world, and she's good. Got nothing.
My gray sweatpants don't do it for me.
Yeah.
I can't hedge my bets on that.
Well, Marquita, I will just say out loud that I'm with you on that. But it's some people that if they were in my purview, you know, I have my fantasy, you know, used to be Janet Jackson, you know, Tony Braxton, like, it's like, woo.
Yeah.
But I feel you. I get you.
I mean, it's not easy. I'm not going to say that it's easy. But like I said, the price tag that is attached.
I'm with you. But when you got a cat like Garen, who's battle testing, he starts spitting that word to you, and he got that smooth thing going on. Yeah. You're like, Lord Jesus, he might be the one.
Yeah. I had a good kid. You know what it's like. I know what it's like.
Yeah. Wow. It's not the falling, it's the getting up.
Yeah. Getting up. Oh, boy.
You know, when I was in my toxicity, I did the same thing. I was sleeping with somebody, and I realized this is not beneficial. And I'm like, we need to stop this. Yeah. And it took the strength for me to say that. It was like, not that I wanted to do it. I mean, you know, who wants to do that? But I starved my flesh to focus on my spirit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and again, it wasn't that I wanted to.
Yeah.
It was just like, I can't keep doing this because I don't want to head down that toxic relationship again.
Yeah.
And I need to be clear when I'm seeing someone if I want to be married again, because I was content being single and I wanted to get married again, but I didn't want to do it for the wrong reasons or get caught up.
Yeah.
You know,
I think the reoccurring theme and Rob and
Wait, Constance, that this is so superficial, but I got to say it.
Go ahead.
I want to make sure I am hearing everyone clearly. You will sacrifice good sex to have a great marriage. So you'll have a great marriage where the intimacy is not so good, because it seems like when the intimacy is good, that equals bad marriage.
Okay.
Good equals bad marriage. So I'm trying to figure out.
I'm gonna say this. You are not always gonna be in your prime. So it's great to have good sex, but what's gonna happen when you 80 and Mr. Johnson ain't working? And if your relationship is based on good sex and you don't have that foundation. So for me, of course I want good sex, but besides that, can we live a life together? Can I really see myself with you at 60, at 70, at 80? Can I see myself with you when the sex is not there? And so for me, that's what I look at.
Yeah. I'll bring it another way. There's 24 hours in a day, you know, and sex is at best usually an hour. So the 20 other hours, you're dealing with that person, you know, and you're not having sex every day. You know, in reality, you're not having maybe once every other day, or, I mean, everybody's different, but let's just think on the average. The average is, say, people have sex, you know, 5 to 10 times a month. So that's a whole lot of hours of not having sex to get to know that person. So do you give up great sex for that person? And that doesn't indicate that if you get a great relationship, that great relationship won't equate to great sex, because there's a different level, a different and a deeper level of intimacy involved in that sexual encounter. Mm-hmm. So if you separate them, then okay, you could, that's an argument. But if you merge them together, there's no saying that because you have a great relationship, it's gonna be bad sex.
Yeah.
And you're missing out on the aspect of making love, the aspect of pillow talk, all that stuff you're missing on, because if you just focus on the sex alone, because yeah. You're basically saying, I just want to bust a nut, you know. And
I mean, but I did hear that the biggest sex organ that we have is our mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's what I keep hearing. So if you can make love to my mind, you know, we will always have good sex for years to come.
So, and I think that's true. Like, if you are highly attracted to somebody, and you know, I think you're going to have good sex.
Yeah.
If you get married to somebody and a sex organ don't work,
what you got?
Your mind. So, Kat.
talk to me. Be able to talk to me.
You know, I'm still learning. I'm on this my journey, brand new. I just got my freedom papers. I'm not trying, you know.
My freedom papers.
I'm just gonna go ahead and marinate over here.
Well, I mean, that's the mistake that some people do, is because I don't want to say that you should test drive at all. I'm not encouraging that at all. But sometimes people will, because they want to make sure that they're married first, they'll get married relatively quickly so that they won't, you know, because Paul said in the Bible, it's better to marry than to burn. And so they'll try to do it as soon as possible without really, you know, because they think this is the right one. But well, I waited. But then you got in there because you wanted to hurry up. You know, I know people who hear that.
And you know what? I'll share this. I have dated, but what I learned quickly about me is I like the beginning part, you know, but when it's like real, I'm like, no, I still need to heal.
You like the fun.
You like the butterflies, but that's when everybody, because everybody sends their representatives. There's nobody that comes in that are showing everything, and you don't really learn about that person until, you know, you get a couple of months down, and then you got to see if this is who you really want to deal with at that point, right?
And what I had to learn quickly is when you're healing, I mean really healing, like I had to heal. I weighed so much, Constance, you know, I was a chunky girl on the bike still, but my passion, if I would not have followed my heart, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. If I would not have walked away, I would not have become a spin instructor. Mm-hmm. You know, just believing in me and knowing, I have to pat myself on the back that I know I'm not ready, and it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
You know what I'm saying? It don't matter what other people say. This is my journey.
This
is my lesson. This is my season. Yeah. So you can take what everybody else is throwing at you. You can learn from it. But at the end of the day, it's your book you're writing, your journey. What is my legacy? When I question myself, what is my existence? I'm hungry for that right now.
Yes, that's good.
Because I know I have a bigger purpose on this earth.
Yes.
And I know I didn't go through things I went through for nothing. Yes. So I'm hungry right now. My soul, my spirit, everything about me is hungry. It's like I'm trying to catch up.
Yeah, it's your time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to say this real quick. Joy, unleash your potential. She was on our show last week when we were talking about lists, and she said that she was abstinent or that she was celibate. And so I mentioned, Rob, when you and I did our show last week about our love language, I said how that she had been celibate for 5 years, and she inboxed me and said, no, let's not get it twisted. I ain't been celibate for 5 years. I just have not been in a relationship for 5 years. So I just wanted to make sure that I acknowledged her.
That's a definite clarification of her status.
I just wanted to make sure I shouted you out because you wanted to make sure that I said the right thing.
That's so funny.
Rob, you have anything?
No, I just want to say that Constance, you have been the...
See, look, Joyce, yes, don't get it twisted, men.
Consummate hostess, and I applaud you for gauging the dialogue, because a lot of these things are, like we said earlier, the silent sufferers, they hold these things, and sometimes it can be too much just to hold on without knowing that there's somebody else like you going through the same process, who has been through the process. So I think part of the healing process is being able to just download or unload that stuff amongst your peers. And this is a safe place. This is a safe space. And as much as I joke, and I might be a little bit crazy about my crock pot experience.
Well, you are right.
And I'm still not married. I just pray that the Lord will find the right woman for me. And I'm going to remember what you said, Garen. Kat, I, you know, God bless you for being so transparent. Marquita, the celibacy thing, you are my new hero. And I'm just going to remember you every time I get tempted. I'm Marquita said.
No, Marquita. the last show, Rob, Marquita did ask you. What did you ask him, Marquita?
Would you be able to date someone who is abstaining? Because that you like the big booty, and like you gave the whole little characteristics. And
why y'all talking about me? And
She was in the comment section, and I looked back at the comments later. She was in the comment section, and she said, Rob, can you date somebody that's celibate?
So the answer is yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Comma, but. We need to have that conversation in the beginning because, you know, I think it's fair to kind of say, hey, here's my stuff.
Yeah.
And here's what I expect. Here's what I will do. Here's what I won't do. And I think that's a valid discussion to have on the front end. I don't think that's a disqualifier. I mean, I think that's beautiful, you know. But you know, depending on who your mate or your partner is, depending on how affectionate he or she is, how touchy-feely he or she is, situations happen. So you need to have a safe word or a strategy.
Make sure
that your walk of celibacy stays intact. And all the saints know that you ain't supposed to be fornicating in the beginning any whole way. But we are all sinful creatures that are falling short every single day in some way, shape, or form. And sex ain't the only way. So
Marquita, Marquita, Rob said no. So anyway,
I could not take that one.
You danced around that real good. However, the Lord will forgive it. You said no. So
let me clarify for the saints who are watching. Robert Antonin said that because of my relationship with God, I respect and understand that fornication shouldn't be a part of the conversation anyway. Fornication should not be a part of the conversation anyway. So if could I? Yes. But I would just say, let's talk about that in the beginning so with all hearts and minds are clear. Because we need to pray about
first date question. First date questions.
First date questions.
Absolutely.
To circle back around, I know we're going to end soon, but I wanted to just say one thing for me in terms of the toxic relationship. One thing that really helped me was I had a strong support system. Mm-hmm. And I just, if my girls are watching, they know who they are. I want to give a shout out to them. They surrounded me with love and encouragement, and just letting me know you are going to be okay. You are going to get through this. And so I think that's something that's really important, to have that strong circle of family or friends that will lift you up and let you know weeping may endure for the night, but joy is going to come.
Come on now.
My girls are watching me because I shared and liked and all that. I want to thank you one more time.
So I just want to say that this is such a great topic, you know, because we really want to make sure that people are being built holistically, mentally, physically, spiritually, financially, all of those things. And this is why this is so important. We got some people who have made it through. We got some people who are going through, and we have some people who are on the other side. And it's so good to get all of the different perspectives and just to show how we could, you know, you can make it. If you are in a toxic marriage, if you're in a toxic relationship, you can make it. The thing that I learned tonight is that you guys all said that you had to work on you. I've heard that. That's the recurring thing. You know, you cannot pour from an empty cup. And a lot of times we come into these relationships broken, pouring from an empty cup. We can't give. Marquita, you said, I did not know how to respect my husband. Yeah. You were not, because you didn't understand. You didn't know. You didn't have that. That wasn't in your lineage. Yeah. And so understanding and recognizing that's huge. That's huge, Jaren. And that's huge, Kat, for you to say, I had to work on me. I just stepped back for a second. You know, I had to be, you know, even if it's being celibate for a month and just saying, doing your divine download and saying, look, I just need to be at one with the Lord, mm-hmm. know who I am so that I can give whatever I need to give to that next relationship. So that's what that's the message that I got. And that's what I want to encourage everybody, is to go back and just look at yourself internally and say, I got to be right with myself. And I got to do the self work, and I got to take out the negative self-talk, and I need to build myself back up to where I can pour from a full cup and not an empty cup.
Yeah.
So thank you guys. We appreciate you. Listen, this word today has been so encouraging to so many. You guys probably saved somebody's life. I'm so serious. Somebody might have been ready to slit their wrists or end it all. Like Kat says, she was ready. She questioned her own existence in this world. And there might be somebody that is just like you that is going through those things that needed to hear this word. You know, I always say that our hardships are the blueprint to help other people. You know, you making it on the other side is what somebody else needed to do so that they can make it too. So them seeing your journey, and I appreciate you said, I wouldn't have done this before, but now you're able to stand on top of it and not be in it. So now that you're on top of it, speak to it and you can help other people. So continue to share your story. Everybody, Jaren, from your perspective of being a man and having to go through abuse, verbal and physical, men ain't speaking out about that. Nope. So thank you for being brave enough to share your truth and share your story with us, because somebody needed to hear that. A whole lot of men ain't going to admit it. They ain't going to put it at the barbershop, Rob. They are not going to say that at the barbershop, right? But they going to listen to Jaren's story, and they're going to make a choice to get out of that toxic situation. And for you, Marquita, God bless you. I pray that you find your soulmate when you're out of this and you can go to the next. I pray that being abstinent does everything that you needed to do so that you can find, and all of you can find, you know, your soulmates. You too, Robert. So thank you guys. I want to also
you too, Robert. You gave everybody so much. Whoa. You too, Robert. Let me tell you, I am fearfully and wonderfully made, and my queen is waiting on me. I'm speaking it right now. In the name of Jesus, how dare you say, and you too.
Why do I feel like we need to pray? Let us pray.
I need you to shower some love on me too. I'm gonna never forget that cut.
You're my co-host. I wanted to see if you had some encouraging words to say to the people.
No. You done blew my spirit. My spirit is damaged right now. And you too, Robert.
Put his Swiss hands on you and pray, Robert, just right there.
Thank you. I receive it. You know what? Let me just say right now, in the name of Jesus, I just ask that you have a divine download in each and every one of your sons and daughters. I ask that you bring them their Boaz or whoever it is that you choose for them. And in the meantime and in the wait time, Lord God, speak to them to let them know that while they're trying to figure it out, you are already working it out. We just thank you for everything that you've done, every lesson and every blessing that you brought in our life. Your credit is good with us. So we thank you in advance for what you're going to do, the great relationship that you're going to manifest in our life. And you too, Robert. And I thank you for this time, this moment, and this opportunity. In the name of your son, Jesus, I just speak blessings and I say amen to all of your sons and daughters.
Amen. Amen. Amen, Robert. Yeah. Let me share what I love about Robert, because you and I have, you know, we are friends. We've prayed together. And I appreciate the fact that you are a prayer warrior. Thank God you didn't pray here as long as you pray when we pray on the phone together. I appreciate that. But you are he is a really good man. He is single. Are you looking?
Look, man, let's wrap this thing up.
So he's a really good man. Great qualities, you know, doing the great things in the world. And I think you mentioned last week when we had the show, you said, I'm really just really focusing on my kids right now because we are trying to build a legacy and all of that stuff. So I appreciate your friendship. I appreciate your love. I appreciate your trust. I appreciate everything that you bring. And I look forward to having these Black love and relationship goal conversations with
all of you. And tell your daughter I'm not short, though. That's what I want you to do that for me.
My daughter thinks that Robert, she knows you. I don't know why she says that you are 5'7", but she says that Robert is 5'7", and he's really, how tall are you, Rob?
6 feet, baby, six.
He is 6 feet tall. So listen, don't get it twisted. This man is 6 feet tall. Thank you guys again for joining us.
Thank you.